Hi, and welcome to the 28th edition of Medford Square TV. I'm your host, Melissa Hurley, and today we have a fun-packed show. But first, let's talk about the Mystic Players' upcoming show called Holiday Follies. It has a great enthusiastic cast of children and adults alike, and will appeal to the child in all of us. But today, we're going to talk to a man who has been instrumental in making every Mystic Players show a success for many years. He's hardworking, dedicated, and a great entertainer in his own right. You know, it's a well-known fact in Medford that a Mystic Players show just isn't complete without the expert emceeing of Mr. Joe Platty. Hey, Joe, welcome once again to Medford Square TV.
Thank you, Melissa, and thank you for those very kind words. And you know, Melissa, it comes to my mind, I think the last time I saw you, you were a very, very little girl, and here you are today interviewing me. Believe me, it's a pleasure.
I've known you for about, the first Mystic Players show I did was about 10 years ago.
And that would make you about 4 years old, maybe?
No, not that young. Now, I know that you've spent a lot of time promoting this show. Who else has worked backstage?
Well, as you know, Melissa, any Mystic Players, everybody, mm-hmm. you know, is involved. I mean, it'd be too many names for me to mention. John Costas and Dick Over and Pat Starella, and so many more. Anna Lynch, and I could go on and on. Helen Plant, and, you know how many people it takes to do a show, Melissa.
Yeah.
More than what the audience sees. The audience sees 30 or 40 people on stage, but you know from your own experience, mm-hmm. there's another 40 or 50 working behind stage in the lobby, of course.
And the Mystic Players always, everyone takes part in everything.
Right. That's what makes us a very unique group. This is why we can keep our ticket prices mm-hmm. low, because none of us get paid, as you well
right.
know.
And Steve Flynn is?
Steve Flynn, the well-known director mm-hmm. of Mystic Players shows in Medford. He's directed many of our Broadway musicals. He's back with us again. And he is directing and staging Holiday Follies at the Chevalier Theater on December 11th at 7:30 p.m. And on December 12th, we have a matinee at 2 p.m. and an evening performance at 7:30. Melissa, I'd like to encourage the adults, if they can, please come to the Friday evening show or the mm-hmm. Saturday evening show. The tickets are going tremendous. They're very high, extremely high, and Saturday matinee right. especially.
Okay, and I know it seems like a family show. There are a lot of adults in it, and I know when you look at the name of it, Holiday Follies, it kind of seems like a children's show, but I know that it has adults in it, and it appeals to everyone.
You're right, Melissa. It is really an adult show. It's a family adult show, and we purposely put this show together. We asked Steve to put this show together with that concept in mind, that it would be enjoyable by older people and teenagers and, of course, children. To do that, Steve had to put songs in the show. Some are Christmas songs, but then there's some rock and roll songs, There's songs there for all age groups. And people can expect to see the Parade of the Wooden Soldiers. They can hear the Christmas candy rock songs. And of course, they'll hear Oh Holy Night. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's something in that show for everybody. Now, we also thought that it'd be a good concept for many of the parents and grandparents to have something there to bring their grandchildren. It's mm-hmm. like spending, a day before Christmas with their children and grandchildren at the Holiday Follies show. And I promise you, Melissa, this is going to be a fun, fun show.
There's
going to be so much excitement that I can't, through the concept of publicity, convey it all to the people, especially on my signs.
We just have to come down and see it.
We're going to have Santa in the lobby. People can bring their own cameras, take their picture with Santa of their children, free. Mm-hmm. Now, if we take the picture, we'll have to charge him $3 because of the film in the frame that we put it in. But absolutely free if they bring their own camera. Then I hope to have Mr. and Mrs. Santa Claus with an elf or two in the lobby. This is just in the lobby. Now, Steve Flynn, the director, has put in this show, we'll have characters of the Sesame Street people and Walt Disney characters. So there's something in this show for everybody, and it should be a show that nobody should miss.
Okay, and tell me about this contest, the most unusual way that Santa could arrive at the North Pole.
I'm glad you asked me that, Melissa. This is a fun contest, and again, everybody in the family can participate in this contest. Hopefully, of course, when they submit it, they would submit the name of a child. Now, the most unusual way that Santa could arrive at the North Pole at Forest Street, Medford. Now, the judges, of course, will be members of the Mystic Players. And what would be some of the most unusual ways, Melissa? On the back of a camel, in a kangaroo pouch, on a bicycle, on a scooter? I mean, we want the most unusual way. Now, the parents can help their children. We have no objection to that. And they can mail their answer to Santa, North Pole, 30 Forest Street, Medford, and the post office will deliver it.
Okay.
And those people who have not seen the North Pole with Santa Claus on the top and the mailbox at in front of Chevalier, they should go and see it. Now, Melissa, I'm going to tell you something on this program that not any of the newspapers have access to, not any of the Mystic Players have access to, but because you and Joe Fortunato have been extremely kind to the Mystic Players, for the first time, I'm going to reveal it here this afternoon. And that is this, Melissa. I have not received one comment about Santa Claus in front of Chevalier, and it's been up there since, about a month now.
Really?
From anybody in the entire city of Medford, or from any newspaper, or any newspaper reporter, and there is something definitely unusual about Santa Claus. And no one has uncovered it. Now, the people of Medford should take a ride by and see if they can uncover it.
Just
but
getting back
contest,
to the contest
the
for a
contest,
second.
Melissa, the prizes are being donated by Toys R Us.
Oh, really?
By Toys R Us. Now, first prize, there'll be a prize every performance. So when they send in their answer, they should send their answer in
indicating
the show that they're participating.
Okay.
So if they're coming Friday night and they should win the contest and they're present, they will get first prize.
Okay.
If they are not present, they will receive second prize.
Oh.
The idea is I want them there.
Yeah.
Now, if they're participating in the matinee show on Saturday afternoon, if they're there, they'll get first prize. If they're not there, they'll get second prize. And the same thing with Saturday evening. So they should be there at the show they intend to participate.
Right.
They will get both prizes if they're there.
And the prizes are being donated by Toys R Us?
The prizes are being donated by Toys R Us, yes.
That's great. And before we wrap this up, the tickets are $5 for adults and $3 for children under 12.
That's right. And Melissa, there's one thing else I would like to ask the viewing audience. If they have any Christmas
decorations.
Anything
for you, Joe.
Oh, thank
you. Go
ahead. If they have any Christmas donations, you know, artificial Christmas trees or wreaths or garland, we'd like to decorate Chevalier to make it look, you know, very Christmassy. And we will pick them up. Now, they can call 396-7900. That's Medford TV and Electronics, 396-7900. We will pick them up. Or, if they can, they can drop them off at Medford TV and Electronics on Salem Street next to Papa Gino's or Alamo Roast Beef.
So if anyone else has any decorations, Christmas decorations, they'd like to donate to the Mystic Players show, Holiday Follies, you can call 396-7900, which would also be the number that you call for tickets. Or you can bring them down to the other Medford Square TV, Medford Square TV and Electronics on Salem Street, right next to Alamo's Roast Beef.
Melissa, may I add that if they don't wish to mail in the answer, they can take their children and bring them right to Forest Street. There's a mailbox in the front, and all they have to do is drop their envelope in the mailbox.
Okay, that would be something fun for kids and parents
meantime,
to do.
They can view Santa Claus and see if
do
they can
they
see
find that?
What's unusual about that Santa Claus.
Okay. Okay, well, this Holiday Follies looks like it's going to be a great show.
It is.
I know I'm not going to miss it, and I'm sure you people out there won't want to either. Joe, thank you for coming down here again to talk to us about
this. Thank you, Melissa, and Joe Fortunato. Thank you very much.
Okay, we'll see you at the show.
I am Helen Mahoney, and I want to keep the Channel 3 here in Medford. Yoo-hoo!
And now here's Phyllis Patten with some news on NCE winter basketball.
Thank you, Melissa. Hi, I'm here to tell you about the MCE Winter Basketball League, directed by Medford High School hoop coach Tom Reiser and the Mustang coaching staff. This winter league will begin on Saturday, December 12th at Medford High School. Boys and girls grade 3 through 8 should register now at the MCE office, Medford High School, 489 Winthrop Street in Medford. This is a great time to learn the game, have fun, play against the best competition. Divisions will be by age and ability levels. The cost is $40. It includes the team t-shirt, court time, instruction, and officiating. Hope all of you out there will go up to the high school and join the basketball league. Thank you. Back to you, Melissa.
Thank you, Phyllis. As you remember, last week Francine Amara showed us her public service announcement on overpopulation. Well, this week Francine's back again to show us another public service announcement on household hazardous waste and other substances we can use in our house that aren't toxic.
When most of us think of hazardous waste, we think of chemical companies dumping toxins into our rivers. While most hazardous waste is produced by big business, an alarming percentage is caused by consumers like you and me. What we don't realize is each one of us contributes to hazardous waste out of our homes each day. Hi, I'm Francine Amari with an environmental alert report for you and your family. Your use of household cleaners, pesticides, paints, solvents, and automotive products generates about 20 pounds of hazardous waste each year. And it is estimated that most homes store an additional 50 to 100 pounds more in hazardous materials that haven't been used yet. Today's report will focus on household cleaners. It's important to remember that what gets poured down the drain or put in the trash could end up in your drinking water, the soil in your backyard, or even the beach you swim at. Most municipal dumps are not properly prepared to deal with the chemicals we use every day. Waste often ends up leaching into and contaminating our groundwater supply. From California to Maine, the nation's groundwater is threatened by pesticides, automotive products, and household cleaners. Some chemicals pass through treatment plants, maintain their toxic properties, and end up in rivers where they contaminate marine life, including the fish we eat. So, how can you tell if you're using products that contain hazardous waste? On the label, if you see the words danger, poison, flammable, warning, acid, caution, or pesticides, you can assume you're dealing with hazardous waste. Here are some substitutes to products you may be currently using. Instead of abrasive cleaners with chlorinol, try scrubbing with baking soda or use 1/2 of a lemon dipped in borax. Instead of toilet bowl cleaners, use Murphy's oil soap. It's non-toxic. Instead of drain cleaners, use 1/2 cup of baking soda followed by 1/2 cup of vinegar, then flush with hot water. Instead of furniture polish, mix 1/4 cup of lemon juice with 3 cups of linseed oil. Instead of ammonia-based cleaners with dyes and perfumes, use plain ammonia or vinegar, salt, and water, or baking soda and water. These alternatives are not only safer, but also often cheaper than products you'll find on your supermarket shelf. If you have small children in your house, getting rid of hazardous materials makes childproofing much easier. If everyone substituted just a few of their cleaners for a non-toxic alternative, it would make a substantial difference. See you next time. The information for today's environmental alert report was provided by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, Dana Duxbury & Associates, and Environmental Hazards Management Institute. If you would like more information on hazardous waste or product substitutes, you can contact Environmental Hazards Management Institute, P.O. Box 932, Durham, New Hampshire, 03824, or call them at 603-868-1496. This has been an Environmental Alert Report, P.O. Box 90, Somerville, Mass., 02143.
I hope you found that informative. And next show, Francine Amaro will do another public service announcement. But right now, here's Phyllis Patten to talk about a recent Curtis Tufts championship football game.
Thank you again, Melissa. We have some film today of the recent championship game between the Curtis Tufts and Saugus Alternative High Schools. Saugus's only loss this year was to the Curtis Tufts. Saugus took an early lead, but the Curtis Tufts came back on a Brian Tivnan touchdown to tie the game. The teams exchanged scores for most of the game, and with 1 minute left in a Curtis four-point lead, Curtis punted deep into Saugus territory. On the second offensive play, the ball was intercepted by Ross Patton and returned to the two-yard line. Brian Tivnan scored on the next play. In addition to Brian's two TDs, Ross Patton had two, Wally Batchelder had one. Keith Collado, playing with a broken nose, and J.J. Guerra both had strong games for the winners. The offensive MVPs of the game were Brian Tivnan and Ross Patton. Defensive MVPs were Wally Batchelder and Anthony Cruz. Curtis Tufts is coached by Walter Lyons and Bob Harrington, and they have had only one loss in the last 2 years of play. They are captained by Brian Tivnan and Miss Brandy Sweeney. Curtis boasts the only co-ed team in the league with two women starters, Brandy and Deanna Zanaboni. They are joined by two other women, Tammy Lyman and Alexis Nuzzo. Seniors on the team are Keith Collado, Tim Droz, Brian Tivnan, Ross Patton, and Brandy Sweeney. Other players who contributed to the championship are Jared Connors, Jason DeVito, Danny Golick, and Bill Smith. Congratulations, Curtis Tufts. We're very proud of you. Back to you, Melissa.
Thanks, Phyllis. And now here's Linda Iannocone with the Medford Chamber of Commerce.
Hi, I'm Linda Iannocone from the Medford Chamber of Commerce. First of all, I'd like to announce some of our new members. From West Medford is Michael Edwards Entertainment Agency. Almont Glass at 427 High Street. Here's Karen at 438 High Street. Export Enterprise at 395 Riverside Ave. Dr. John Gentuso at 0 Governors Ave. And Michael Kelleher at 33 Guild Street. I'd like to tell you about the City of Medford, the Chamber of Commerce, and the United States Marine Corps Reserve. Invite everybody in the City of Medford and their families to a Toys for Tots holiday celebration. It will be on Wednesday, December 16th, 1992, the time, 5:30 p.m., and the place is Pedestrian Mall on Riverside Ave. We will have a visit from Santa Claus, the lighting of the menorah, the lighting of the city tree, Temple Shalom Hebrew School Chorus, and the Hay Rides with Santa, the Mondello Band, and the Medford High School Multicultural Ensemble. We also will have coffee, hot chocolate, and cider for your enjoyment. I am sitting here now with David Boudreau, and Joe Fortunato is making us laugh. So if you wonder why every once in a while we have this silly grin on our face, it is because Joe Fortunato is standing behind the camera acting like a silly. I am here with David Boudreau, our first vice president from the Medford Savings Bank, and he is going to tell you about the contest that the Medford Chamber of Commerce is initiating.
Hi, Medford. To encourage local businesses to spruce up for the holidays, we'd like all Medford businesses to enter our contest at no charge. And what we'd like you to do is decorate your place of business as Christmassy as possible. And any local business can enter. We're going to be offering prizes, free advertising in the Medford Transcript, gift certificates to different dining establishments, and free tickets to future Chamber of Commerce events. So please call Linda Iannocone at the Medford Chamber of Commerce if you haven't already received a flyer.
It's in the paper.
Or it is in the Medford Transcript, inviting you to join the contest. And the prizes will be chosen by a chamber committee. First prize, second prize, and honorable mention. And the prizes, winners will be announced December 23rd. So please spruce up for the holidays and join the Medford Chamber of Commerce in decorating our city of Medford.
And you must send this into the chamber office to be eligible so that the committee will come by your office, or even the banks are included. There will be a special category for banks and offices. But you must get your application in in order for the committee to come and visit your office or your place of business.
Thank you, Linda, for making that important point.
That was Linda Iannocone and David Vidrow of the Medford Chamber of Commerce. Boy, they seem to have a really good time at the Medford Chamber of Commerce. Well, we're running out of shopping days until Christmas. And Gary Zapelli has a music video for us now about the busiest shopping day of the year, the day after Thanksgiving. It was taken in Boston. And take it away, Gary.
Hello again, everybody. I am Gary Zapelli, and this is Medford Square TV. Well, the turkey has finally been carved, and the last of the turkey leftovers has finally been served, and thank God for that. It's now time to set our sights on Christmas, and that's exactly what I plan to do here for you on Medford Square TV. This week, I decided to take a camera out on the busiest shopping day of the year, and that obviously is the day after Thanksgiving. Took a camera in town. Among the places that we stopped off at was Copley Place, Downtown Crossing, and a few other places. Took some film, we put it to music, and this is what we got. So I'll be back right after the video to give you just a few announcements on some upcoming events here in the city. So if we can now, Joe, just roll the tape.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. I really had a good time doing it, filming it. I would like to also point out a special thanks to Susan Keating for allowing me to use her car as a filming vehicle. So, Susan, I thank you very much, and we had a great time doing that. Anyway, some upcoming events here in the city on December 10th. The Medford Saving Lives program will be sponsoring a tree lighting ceremony at the Royal House, and the public is invited to come on down to check it out. That'll be December 10th at the Royal House. Also, I'll be back next week. I'll have some fashion tips for you for the holidays, just in time for that big Christmas work party. And also, Lorraine Road in Medford. Now, every year, the residents of Lorraine Road get together and they light up their houses with Christmas lights, and it's just a beautiful sight to see. And actually, I guess last year, they had a tour bus that actually stopped by to see this beautiful sight. So we'll get that on film as soon as they do. And also next week, I am going to show you how to pick out the perfect Christmas tree. So I'm sure you'll want to stay tuned for that. Anyway, that's it for me, Gary Zapelli. Remember, during this holiday season, try to be nice to the person next to you. A little courtesy goes a long, long way. So with that in mind, let's send it back inside to the warm studio with you, Melissa.
Thank you, Gary. Well, your music videos are becoming a regular part of Medford Square TV, and I should add a popular one. Well, right now, here's Joe Fortunato with a story about the Medford Papuano Cheerleaders.
Hello, this is Joe Fortunato from Medford Square TV, and I'm here with Debbie Flynn and Guy Matorano. Debbie Flynn is Director of Cheerleader for Medford Papuana. Hello, Debbie.
Hello, Joe. Nice to see you.
Good to see you. And Guy Matorano is the president of Papuana here in Medford. He's in charge of the football program as well as being president of the cheerleading program all combined. And Debbie, can you tell us how the girls have done this year with the cheerleading?
Well, the cheerleading teams have had an outstanding year so far, Joe. Our four cheerleading teams, A, B, C, and D squads, have, besides cheering for their respective football teams all season long, have gone on to win the GBL title for the A, B, and C teams, with our D team coming in second. And the B and C teams have gone on to win the Conference of Eastern Massachusetts title, and are looking forward to possibly New England regionals and hopefully national competition in Jacksonville.
That's great. I guess, was it last year they went on to the nationals? Was it in California?
It was in Jacksonville last year. Our B and C teams, our B team was the national champion last year, and our C team was second runner-up in nationals. Yes.
That's quite an accomplishment.
Yes,
the A, B, C, and D squad, are those the different age groups?
Yes, the A squad are 13-year-olds. The B are older 11 and 12. The C are 10 and 11, and the D are 8 and 9.
And Guy, can you tell us a little bit about the football program here in Medford?
Well, first, let me congratulate Debbie for a fine job she has done in the last past three to four years. Our football program is on the rise. Like our A team did fairly well. Well, I'll give you their records, but we don't try to say win or loss. We go, is the boy learning through the program and getting ready for high school? So the A team was 1-9, and the B team was 6-3, and the C team was 3-6, and the D team was 3-6. So our program is getting the boys with the fundamentals, teaching them, and getting them ready to go up to the high school. That's where it counts, in high school.
Are they playing the teams from other Greater Boston League cities, Papuana in Everett and Malden?
They play Everett, Malden, Somerville, Cambridge, East Boston, Chelsea, and Revere.
That's great. Debbie, obviously you must have a lot of help here with four squads competing in Papuana.
Yes, we do, Joe. We have an awful lot of adult volunteers. We have four moms, a mom from each team that works with the girls, that helps to supervise and make sure that they're safe at all times, as well as their coaches who have been cheerleaders in the past, who have cheered for Medford High School or Arlington Catholic, and they're very dedicated, hardworking young girls that give up an awful lot of time and try to handle cheering and work and their studies all at the
and
same that, time.
And that's Alyssa and Amy?
Our C's team coaches are Amy Roth and Elisa DeStacio, and our B team coaches are Kelly Granara and Erin Murphy, and our B team squad mom is Sandy DiGiacomo, and our C team mom is Tony Ciampa.
We're going to show a little cheer from the Greater Boston League Championships held at Everett recently. I hear you're one of the founders of Pup Warner in Medford. How long has Pup Warner football been going on here in Medford?
Since 1967. We started up in West Medford at the community center. We didn't have any money or anything. The uniforms were all borrowed from different schools. Kids had their own helmets. And after the first year, I got together with a lot of parents, and we start raising money, and we start buying the equipment for the next year. We played down at Duggar Park for a couple of years. Then we moved to Plaisted Park. First we had A, B, and C, we call them then. And then that year we had about 56 kids that playing on a C team. So we had it next year, we decided to put in a D team. And at that time it was starting with 7 years old. Today it's 8 years old on the D team. But at that time, it was 7 years old, so we formed the D team. So then the following year, we had four teams. And we built up the program, which has lasted since 1967. It's over 25 years.
And the cheerleading, Pup Warner cheerleaders started getting involved a couple of years later?
Later, yes, a couple of years later.
And Debbie, how long have you been involved?
This is my fifth year with the program.
But the cheerleaders, see, haven't really became the way it is so popular today as the last past 5 or 6 years.
When Debbie got involved.
Well, right, yes, right. Yes, but see, now cheerleading is such a big program in the Pop Warner organization. and it complements each other, football and cheerleaders.
I mean, we are a football program, and our program has started with football players, and the cheerleaders support the football players.
Obviously.
Most definitely, and, you know, without one, you can't have the other, so we can't have cheerleaders without our football players, and we try and support them and work as well as we can with everybody pulling all together.
And a lot of the cheerleaders go on to be cheerleaders at Medford High or in other high schools in the area, is
yes,
that right?
Yes, they do try. It is very difficult. Medford High School's cheerleading squads are of a high level. They're very tough, strong squads. We like to say that we have some really good squads here in Medford Pop Warner. I think we do. But high school cheerleading is very different and a lot more difficult. And hopefully the kids will be able to continue. We have had some Pop Warner cheerleaders go on to. We have some girls that are presently cheering on the JV teams as well as the varsity teams up at the high school.
I'd like to interrupt. My daughter come up through Pop Warner, and she became captain of the cheerleading at Medford High, and she was a good cheerleader too back
well,
then.
Well, tell us a little bit about your son's guy.
Well, I've always explained to the public my sons, but I always forget my daughter all the time. But I just want to let you know about my daughter too. She was a head cheerleader at Medford High. She ran track, she played basketball, and played tennis and softball. And she was a credit to the family as the boys were.
And the boys were very talented. And I want to ask you right now, how's David doing? He went on a baseball scholarship, actually.
Yes, David's been in the minor leagues 2 years. First year was at Utica, and then they shift him to South Bend, Indiana last season. Now he's back in college. He's getting his BS at Flagler College in St. Augustine, and he'll graduate December 12th. And then he's waiting for a contract from the White Sox to go to spring training.
That would be wonderful. David's a good kid. Everyone likes David.
Yes.
Now the C squad is practicing right next to us over here. Let's go and hear one of their cheers. Right now I want to ask how Pop Warner can afford to outfit all of these teams and travel around. It must be very expensive to travel around Massachusetts and travel recently to Florida and competitions you have to get to. How do you raise funds?
Well, we have dances, we have cannings, the whole board. We've got a 15-member board, and we have parents, team mothers that all get behind the football program, and we raise this money. And you have to raise money to do things for the boys, to buy uniforms and to keep the program going. And now that the girls are in the competition, it's going to take a little bit more money to get the girls out to Jacksonville if their winners is coming Saturday and Sunday. And I urge everybody to get behind the girls and help them out. Win or lose, they're still up. Our little daughters, and they're our sons, and we want to see them get right up there and get what's coming to them.
They do a good job representing Medford, right. And they're very well known around the state.
Yes, they are. Yes. And at this time, I'd like to say thank you to everybody in the community who has helped out in supporting the girls when they're out there canning or any type of fundraiser that they're doing in order to raise money, selling chances or whatever. Every little bit helps, and it does take an awful lot of money, especially if the girls will be going to Florida. There are two squads of girls. There are somewhere in the vicinity of 46 girls, and there are coaches that have to attend with them. It's expensive to do it, but it's an opportunity in a lifetime. Some of these girls might never cheer again, whether it be high school or college, and they can always look back and realize that when they were young, they did this with Medford Pop Warner.
That's great. We're all really proud of you, and we're here with Guy Matorano. Thanks for being with
Thank
us,
you,
the
Mr.
president
Fortunato.
Of Pop Warner in Medford, and Debbie Flynn, the director of cheerleading.
Thank you very much, Joey.
Pop
appreciate
Warner.
Your time.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joe Platty, and I want my Channel 3 in Medford.
Thanks, Joe, for that informative story. The Medford Pop Warner Cheerleaders have had a great season, and it's all under the direction of Debbie Flynn, who puts in countless hours to help these young girls. Well, right now we have Fran Giordano. But before we hear his excerpt sports opinions, Fran Giordano is an independent sports fan, and his opinions and views may not be the opinions and views expressed by the host, hostess, and the producer, anyone else involved with Medford Square TV. But here he is, Mr. Fran Giordano.
Hi, sports fans. I'm Fran Giordano for Medford Square TV Sports, the award-winning station. Well, it's December, and the big news in Boston right now is baseball. Baseball? Why baseball? Well, believe it or not, Kirby Puckett is in town, and everybody's eyes are open. Puckett, the perennial all-star, probably considered by most people one of the best players in the game today because of his extraordinary ability not only to hit for average, but for power, to steal bases, and for his defense, is a free agent, and he's coming to Boston. He's been in Boston. He's checking us out. And from what I've heard, he's also coming back again. So he's given us a second look. Maybe Kirby has his eyes set on Boston, and what an addition he would be playing center field for the Red Sox. And what about Mark McGwire? He's a free agent too. And boy, what a first baseman. Home run power, RBI power, and a great glove at first. Boy, two additions like that, Red Sox from the cellar, definitely contenders for first place. Well, let's just take a slap shot and jump on into hockey. And when we talk about hockey right away, we're thinking of the Boston Bruins. They were hot before, and they're still hot now. And they're being led by Joey Junot. Well, that's right, folks. That's how he's pronouncing his name now. I guess once you get a little famous, we change the pronunciations, the same as Eric Lindros. Well, anyway, Junot is out there scoring. I believe, as a matter of fact, he has more points now than any other rookie who's in contention for the Rookie of the Year award. And that includes Seleni from Winnipeg, because I believe he falls into the same category as Katavalov, who is a little bit too old for the Rookie of the Year honors. But Junot is out there. He's scoring. He's helping the Bruins. He's giving them what a lift this team is this year. And they have a great first line now. And how about the rest of the league? We still see Mario Lemieux. He's still hot as lava. Up there in the top of the scoring league, this guy is just picking up 3-4 points a game. He's into the 60s already. I mean, you can't stop him. I don't know how they can stop him. Not too many people have. And speaking about points, Sean McEachran will probably give Joey Junot, he'll probably give him a run for that Rookie of the Year award because he's putting up numbers too out there in Pittsburgh, and it sure doesn't hurt playing for that team. And how's this? We got a letter from Johnny Passapia, and he says, you know, remember years ago, folks, they used to name the lines in hockey. Well, he got a nickname for the Oats, Kavatanov, and Junot line. And, you know, everyone's calling the Soviet kids Special K. So he figures with Special K and Oats, he's calling them the cereal line. It's not bad, Johnny. We like that one. Well, we got the Medford watch, and at our last totals, we found Keith Kachuk of Winnipeg with 9 goals and 4 assists, and Joe Sacco of the Toronto Maple Leafs checking in with 4 goals and 3 assists. Well, let's move on into basketball, and, well, Celtics have had their problems lately. Yeah, the team has lost 6 in a row for there at one point. They were down to 2-8 in the standings, and as a matter of fact, that was their worst showing since, guess when? The year before they got Larry Bird. So I don't know if this is an omen or not. With Bird gone, there could be something to watch in the future. They won 3 in a row after that, but you know, you can't have an up and down season like that. Chris Ford has to get more from the players. Right now there's no chemistry. They're not gelling together, and he's got to get just a little bit more out of them. Season's still young. We got a long way to go. But hey, we said that about the Red Sox in June, and the same thing was happening in September. So let's not fret right now. We know the Celtics are going to turn it around. And how about the rest of the league? Well, there's no surprises. Chicago's off and running. Portland is having a tremendous start. And, hey, the big surprise again, Orlando and Charlotte. These two teams are looking for playoff positions. And they've got some young players, some good quality players. And I bet these two teams will be in the playoffs come the end of the season. And, well, let's move on into football. And we know the bubble burst in Foxborough. Well, you know, 2 wins in a row, it had to end. The Patriots fell back to their old ways. Offense, no points. Defense on the field for most of the game. Mishap after mishap. And, you know, what can you say? The Patriots this year are just lacking that killer instinct. They just can't put any points on the board, and that's really taking its toll on the defense. But here's a question for you. Can anybody out there name me a quarterback who has played for the Patriots, won every game at Foxborough Stadium that he started? Answer, Doug Flutie. That's right. Doug Flutie was 10-0 at Foxborough, never lost a game. And guess what? Congratulations to Doug Flutie, because he just won the Grey Cup for the Calgary Stampeders, which is Canada's equivalent to the Super Bowl. Flutie had an outstanding game, 33 out of 49 passes, 480 total yards in passing. Outstanding for the kid who couldn't make it in Boston. He was too short, they said. He won the MVP of the game. He got the MVP of the season. And you know what? He's only one inch shorter than the quarterback, the backup quarterback who's taking Montana's place, young out there in San Francisco. So let's see if we can get Doug back here in Boston. Well, we got some announcements we'd like to make here at Medford Square TV. And one of our first announcements is we'd like to congratulate all the new inductees to the Medford Mustang Hall of Fame. Outstanding careers for these people, and we're proud of them. And how about being proud of the Pop Warner cheerleaders, especially the Beat Squad? They came in first place in the New England Regional Championships for 1992. And you know what? These girls will be off to Jacksonville, Florida, and they're going to be competing in the national for the national title. And speaking of the girls, you know, it takes a lot of money to get there, so they'll be out there raising funds. Any little bit you can help, any little bit you can contribute will be deeply appreciated. They need a little money, so let's see what we can do for these kids. And how about, we'd like to thank City Councilor Robert Penta and the rest of the Medford City Councilors for their recognition of the Medford Square TV for its cast and crew for its outstanding awards that we received at the Cable Commission. So we want to thank the City Councilor for everything. And how about, finally, our trivia question. We had a couple of responses. Our last question was, who was the only pitcher to win four Cy Young Awards in a career? And the correct answer was submitted. We had two people send their answers in. The correct one was sent in by Mike Craven. The answer, of course, is Steve Carlton, the only pitcher to ever win four Cy Young Awards. And his answer was Steve Carlton. Congratulations, Mike. But we also had the correct answer from Joseph Palazzo. But Joe, you were a couple of days later than Mike's entry, so we have to go with Mike as the winner. And Mike, you win your $5 gift certificate, good at Imperial Crown Sports Cards on the corner of Harvard and Maine. Now for this week's question, what NBA team holds the single most wins in a season at home? I want the team and its record for that year, okay? What was their record for the most wins at home by an NBA team? Now, if you know the answer, jot it down on a piece of paper, a postcard, an envelope, a napkin, anything. Send it to Medford Square TV, P.O. Box 379. Hey, you never know what you can win. This week, we're going back to our pictures. We got a gorgeous picture, Joe DiMaggio and Lou Gehrig. This is courtesy of Arthur's Pastry Shop of 382 Main Street. It's a beautiful picture, suitable for framing. I'm telling you, this highlights anyone's den. So if you know the answer, just send it down, and we'll see what happens. And now, we're going to go right back to Melissa Hurley, and she's back here in out there in Medford Square covering the beat. So back to you, Melissa.
Thank you, Fran Giordano. As we all know, Medford Square is changing its appearance. A major street is being opened to traffic, and many new businesses are opening up their doors to Medford residents. As you walk through the ever-changing square, there's a feeling of hope, one for a new beginning. Today, I'd like to talk to an owner of a local Riverside deli, Tony Gigandi. Tony Gigandi is a Medford resident and a successful businessman. His meals are reasonably priced and have attracted such local celebrities as Bill Marlowe, who raved about his sandwiches for more than 15 minutes on primetime radio. Tony, thank you for taking the time to talk to us today. I know you're busy.
Thank you. Well, I feel as if Medford Square is going to come back with the opening of the street, and I felt as if it would be a good opportunity, you know, to take advantage of the square opening. I know there's going to be a big influx of people and automobiles and new businesses in the square, and you know, I figured I'd come down over here instead of going to Boston, paying that high rent. This is just right for me. And I'm able to give low prices and quality products.
Now, Tony, I know you've been open for a few weeks. Have you gotten any feedback from the customers? Are they in favor of the square opening?
Oh, yeah, definitely. A lot of people are responding well to the square opening. They're coming down. They're supporting the businesses. You know, I feel, you know, this is going to really boom the square.
There's a local Medford resident walking through the new square. Now, Medford Square seems to have a tendency for restaurants not really to survive in Medford. A lot of them open and then they close, as do a lot of the stores in Medford Square have opened and then closed because they just don't have the clientele or the customers. Do you see as more of like a new beginning with this opening?
I think with the square, I think the problem here was when, as a young man going to high school, this square was bustling. You had buses, here comes a bus now, there was buses, there was cars, it was very, very busy. And, you know, I see this returning. I think what happened was by closing the square, they stifled all the business owners, they stifled the traffic, and a lot of them couldn't survive. And now, with this reopening, you see a lot of places are gonna open down here catering to the Medford citizens. And that's basically it. I think the opening of the square is going to do it. And while it was closed, it killed a lot of the businesses. People couldn't get access to get in here.
Well, I hope so. And I'm glad to see that Medford residents are also taking this opportunity to open up business in Medford.
Mm. Well, that's it. There's a lot of them. There's a lot of them opening over here. There's like three more coming in, three more businesses. There's another Medford residence, I believe, that's going to put a store right next to us here as well.
Well, that's great. Tony, do you know when the square will be completed?
Well, I believe they're saying April 1st, and there'll be unmetered two-hour parking on each side of the street. And there'll be bus pickup here, and you'll be able to park. It'll be a nice spot to drop your car off and come down for breakfast and or whatever, and, you know, go to one of the local businesses here and head into Boston without paying that $15, $20 an hour, a day parking fee.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah. But, you know, that's basically it. Sundays, we're open. I tell people if they want to come down, you can park over here, pull in front here, because no one's going to bother you. And that just brings us back to the whole thing about what happened to the square. A lot of people parking on the other side, on the back side of the ring road. And what's happening is they can't find me over here. So this is what happened to all these businesses here. This, it takes a big guys at City Hall to admit a mistake and rectify it. And, you know, I praise them, and I think things will really turn around here. I really believe it.
Okay, well, I can tell just from standing here, we've seen a lot of customers, potential customers, walking around the square, and I'm sure when the square is completed, there'll be a lot of people will come back into Medford, start using the Medford Square.
Exactly.
For all their shopping needs. And I want to thank you for talking to us today and continued success.
Thank you. Come down and say hello. Take care.
Hi, my name's Marissa McKay.
And I'm Stephanie Uzgonti.
And we want on Medford Square TV.
Okay, I hope you enjoyed this 28th edition of Medford Square TV. I'm your host, Melissa Hurley, saying goodbye. And wait a second, we want to say happy birthday to Gary Zapelli. He's celebrating his birthday on December 4th, this Friday. So happy birthday, Gary, from everyone here at Medford Square TV, and I'm sure from all the citizens of Medford. And we'll be back next time. Bye.